Okay, that's quite enough of that. Status quo with you read.
Different times.
Now, in order to cleanse your musical mind after hearing that, we have none other than the brilliant Richard Hawley, who's performing Further, the title track from his new album, for you right now.
The ocean is calling as we're working in the grime. I've got a notion for that ocean. We're getting closer all the time. We get further down the line. Feeling and dreaming. Oh, they've still not made that a crime. A silence is falling. No need for words when all is fine. We're getting further down the line.
I want to write songs. Not that I would write them as good as that, but that makes me want to learn how to play the guitar. How long does it take on average, producer Tom, to learn how to play the guitar, do you reckon?
I'm still trying, and I've been doing it for about 10 years, so...
Richard, how long does it take? When did you... How old were you? Six. So I'll be about 90 by the time I get to be as good as Richard Hawley. Everybody, round of applause again for Richard Hawley. And Shez as well, of course. Richard's going to come in and speak to us and perform again before the end of the show. That was Further, the title track from the album, which came out in the summer. It is now 32 minutes past three. Helen Place is here with the news headlines.
On digital, BBC Sounds, smart speaker and online.
This is BBC Radio 5 Live.
This is BBC Radio 5 Live, available on the BBC Sounds app. Nihal Arthanayake.
Singer-songwriter, guitarist, producer Richard Hawley is sitting in front of me, and you just heard him play, as I said, the title track from the album Further. So beautiful. Just stunning. I was transfixed.
Thank you.
Watching you do that. It's not much else you can say. It's a statement rather than a question. One thing that I do love about you is how very stylish you are.
Am I?
Yes. Come on, man. That doesn't just happen. The way you look doesn't just happen. There's thought that goes into that.
Some, really. I was brought up by quite stylish blokes, you know.
Really?
Yeah.
Where fashion was important when you were growing up.
Yeah, I mean...
Or style, because the two things are different.
Before the advent of kind of off-the-peg stuff, you know, my granddad and all his brothers, you know, they were born on, you know, in Duke Street in Sheffield, and it was a slum, you know. And my dad and all his mates, they'd have stuff tailor-made. Or they'd, you know, because it wasn't massively expensive, because there wasn't really that many department stores. No. So you'd have to think about it. And I guess they just poured over loads of kind of, you know, going to see movies, watching Tony Curtis or someone like that, and, you know, how did they dress, you know, and kind of copying that, I guess.
Was there a day of the week when the grown-ups would get kind of dressed up to go? Was it a Friday night, a Saturday night? Did everything
Friday come? And Saturday.
Friday and Saturday yeah. night, okay.
And if they were being really risky, it'd be Sunday night as well. But right. then you'd have to deal with Monday morning, you know.
And what were the social events that they must have gone to then? What was a kind of social life like for you, for your parents especially?
Working men's clubs.
Right, okay.
You know, and we used to go to a family social club on Barnsley Road opposite Northern General Hospital called St Cuthbert's, and that was interesting. Because, you know, like, because the generations now are quite polarised, and then everybody would just go to this place, so there'd be kind of, you know, families with babies, you know, younger kids, teenagers, and then 20-year-olds, you know, right up to octogenarians and beyond, and it'd be everyone together, so there wouldn't be that kind of... You'd still kind of do stuff with your mates, you know, in the park or whatever. But there was like that thing at the weekend where everybody got together and, you know, you watched adults get drunk, so you learned how to do it properly. Rather than the candle lager in park, you know.
What about, I mean, yeah, that is, you're at the kind of coal face of human interaction.
Although we did a bit of that as well.
Right, okay. But what about that environment, I guess? Because obviously people were smoking there. It's the 70s and the 80s. Yeah. People were smoking in there. Presumably sometimes, once in a while, someone had a tear-up in there, and there was people who kind of fell out and kind of outside.
It was always Saturday nights, that, weddings. It was whenever there was a wedding booked, it'd always kick off. Every time. Without fail. Happy days.
Happy days. What was entertainment like, Richard, in those places? How did people entertain it? Were there comedians? Were there bands?
Yeah, comedians. And I mean, I played a lot of them with my uncles, you see. I started playing... working men's clubs and all that, and pubs, when I was 12, you know. I went to Europe with my Uncle Chuck, his real name was Brian, and he used to do like a Jerry Lee Lewis sort of rock and roll thing, and I think I was about 14, 15, maybe 16, I can't remember now. And he said he couldn't get an adult guitarist to go with him, so he kind of lied to my mum and said, oh, we're playing these really nice theatres, you know, and at that age... About a week later, I was playing strip bars in Hamburg, you know. That was an eye-opener.
And, at 12?
No, older than that. At 12, right, I was playing clubs and pubs with Dad. I had to get led in the back door, because, you know, especially in working men's clubs, because they didn't have that. But no, I went on a European tour. I was, you know, mid to late teens, I think. And I left a very innocent person. I came back and I got a real taste for grolsch. And also, you know, they thought I'd turn posh because we were, I came back saying, "Mom, can you get this stuff called mayonnaise?" Because we always had ketchup on us chips. And all the kids in Holland, in the steel towns like Tilburg, which I loved because it was kind of like playing home, and all the kids in Hamburg and Berlin and, you know, all over Europe, they all had mayonnaise on the chips.
Rotterdam, I guess.
Yeah, all that, you know. And, yeah, I came back with just, you know, I love Grolsch. That was before they started importing it.
Yeah.
Obviously, I'm not trying to promote that.
No,
it's
no.
It's just a specific lager.
Long before Bros fans were taking the tops from them and putting them on their Dr. Martens.
Well, we used to, I actually probably one of the first people to bring that idea, those little rubber things. We use them to put them on guitar straps, you see, to stop the strap coming off. I should have patented that.
You thing. Made use of the Gross Top before yeah. Bros fans
didn't just cob it in bin. We used it on guitars, you know.
What a fascinating kind of teenage years. Did it? What did that do for your kind of confidence?
I'm still dealing with it now. Still putting up, just trying to work that one out already, you know.
Because that's growing up very quickly, isn't it?
Yeah, massively quickly, you know. But I was playing, you know, with adults.
And were you treated like one of them? I mean, you were just...
You had to be. There was no... I mean, the thing was, there was no none of that kind of teenage angst thing. This wasn't time for it. You just had to get on with it. You know, none of that sort of being a pain. You know, you just had to mix with people. And they were all kind of... We were all in the same boat, you know. And I just remember travelling around Europe really, really young in a white van that had only got enough room for three people in the front. So I used to be in the back with no windows, like laying on the amps for hundreds of miles. And we had to cross the German border, I remember that. How we got onto this, I don't know, but I could sit and happily talk about it forever. And it was... This is how long ago it is. It was when the Baader-Meinhof gang was still a threat
right,
in Germany,
yeah.
Really serious, real
yeah.
threat. And I was just a kid and... they said, here you go, kid. I think they stopped about 5 miles, two miles before the border and gave me my passport and I had to walk over. And I'd never been out of Sheffield, let alone...
Yeah. Walking across the German border?
Yeah, with all these guys with machine guns and that, you know. And then about, you know, a couple of miles after the border, I'd get back in and get back in the van because if they got caught with somebody in the back of the van without a seat or windows, we'd have got busted.
Because, I mean, you still live in Sheffield. What was it like to go back to Sheffield when you've seen so much? A lot of people want to, I mean, I guess, and I do, you know, look, I've got some love for the town I grew up in, but I couldn't wait to escape it.
Mm. Where were you brought up then?
In Harlow in Essex, right. Or near Harlow yeah, yeah. in Essex. And they're just a feeling that I just wanted to see more of the world. Mm. You're a teenager seeing more of the world and then returning.
Yeah.
Did it always feel like, comfortable to come home? You wanted to just be home, and when you were at home you
yeah,
were happiest.
I liked it, you know. I remember getting back off that tour actually, and my mates who I was in a band with called Tree Bound Story, which was our first school band, they were all waiting for me in the house because they'd miss me. I remember that, you know. And yeah, just come. I guess I've not really got a true perspective of it in one respect, because I've always been lucky enough to be asked to travel and do interesting things and then come back. And, you know...
Well, you know you're not trapped there. That's the point, isn't it? Because you've travelled the world. And
like, yeah, I mean, there was periods of time, like a lot of, you know, not just me, but a lot of northern boys and girls when, you know, Thatcher took over. If we weren't part of her plans, you know, that area, South Yorkshire, was where the miners and the steel had the biggest strength, really. So that was where the hammer blow fell, you know. And when we were 12 years old, it was over, you know. And I was lucky, me, that I'd got the guitar, you know, that I'd been playing since I was a kid. And my family was a musical family. And I, looking back, you know, I was so lucky to have that. Even if I was playing pubs and working men's clubs, or I've bust in the past, you know, when I needed to eat. And I knew that I'd still got that to kind of earn a living. Basically, my guitar has been a shovel, but it's got six strings on it, you know.
Did you notice that time in the 80s there was a palpable change in people's hopes and aspirations?
It was immediate. You could just see, I was old enough, my sisters are younger than me, but it was immediate. The minute that, you know, she got into power, we knew, everybody knew. And I was old enough to be told, you know, it was over.
What does that do to the psychology of a group? I mean, for you, like you said, you had a ticket out with your guitar.
Well, that was only a one possible chance, you know.
Yeah, and it wasn't a given, was it?
Well, no, because it's not, you know, like these days, I think the big difference between, not everybody, you know.
You were 12 when she came in, was it?
Yeah, I don't want to generalise, but, you know, I know a lot of people who pick up an instrument, they do it as a career move rather than loving the thing. Because with playing in any instrument, you have to be in it completely and utterly. It has to take over your very being, you know. You've got to be at one with it, you know. I feel weird if I haven't got a guitar within reaching distance, you know. It just feels strange. And the beauty about a guitar with travel is, you know, if you check into hotel rooms and whatever, is they're generally kind of faceless places and they're very sterile. You put a guitar in a corner, it's also a piece of furniture, you know what I mean? It's kind of, that's kept me sane on many occasions, you know, traveling, doing, I did 3 9-month tours of America in the 90s back to back, and that nearly tipped me over the edge, you know. But having that guitar in the corner in the hotel room kept me sane, you know.
Was there an acceptance in your family that you could do whatever you wanted to do in life?
Yeah, you know, there was always that, well, you know, you might have to... I come from a family of steelworkers and nurses and for many, many generations, you know. And the nurses, I'm not going to say women v men, but a lot of the nurses would, you know, you better have another string to your bow, no pun intended, to maybe, you know, think about getting a proper job. But, you know, at 15, 16, playing pubs and clubs, playing 6-7 nights a week, you know, I was earning the same almost that, you know, my mum was. Working nights in Northern General, you know.
And how old were you when that feeling about a guitar and you, that symbiotic relationship between you, became real?
I remember the first time I missed it. You know, we went on holiday to Chapel St. Leonard's. And, it was Cleethorpes we went to, which, you know, if you were talking to a neighbour that you were trying to pretend you were posh, you'd pretend you'd been to Greece, so we called it Clethrapes, you know. And, I've been to Clethrapes. Oh, it was so hot, you know. Not that I would, but I did hear neighbours talking like that. It was very funny.
Clethrapes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, we've been to Clethrapes. It were marvellous, you know. But, yeah, I just remember, I can't remember, it was about 11 or something like that, going to Cleethorpes, and then really missing it because it wasn't there, you know. So from being quite young, just felt attached to it, you know.
Well, look, I want you to do a second track for us now and then come back and talk some more.
Right.
And in the meantime, if you are from the Clethrapes Tourist Board, maybe you can send us a nice bottle of Ouzo.
Yeah.
From the Clethrapes Riviera.
Yeah.
Richard, if I could ask you to make your way in, I'll do it in a kind of Jules Holland way where I put up and make your way over to Chez, who's still there.
We have to make a bit of a noise because we've got a tune up.
Oh, that's fine.
I don't know whether you need to play a tune.
No, that's all right. In Five Live, I can just talk.
Great.
I can just talk about stuff.
Okay.
You know. If there are any other examples you have of neighbours that you know that kind of bigged up places, they used to do this in London, that you lived in Battersea, which is Battersea, or St. Reetham instead of Streatham. You know, people that, Spudgy-like Spadooly Chaos, producer Dan has just pointed out. St. Evenage. Thank you, Alan. Yes, St. Evenage. You mean Stevenage? No, yes, but you obviously don't know its original name, the Normans, St. Evenage. If you have Clethrapes or any other superb 85058, that is the text number if you want to get in contact with us. This is a brilliant Richard Hawley, and what a life lived already. Imagine that. When he was going out touring with his relatives in a band, I was picking cucumbers. That was my first job. And if we were lucky, we got to go in the lorries with the lovely Russo family, Jimmy and Vince. We managed to go out and get in a lorry and go down. If our parents, it was the school holidays, and we would get to go down to all those markets, Covent Garden, Borough Market, with a lorry full of cucumbers. Not quite touring. Okay, if you have any more examples of where you or your relatives have made out you're going somewhere you're not, then do get in contact with us. As a Sheffield girl and member of one of the many musical families, everyone knows a Hawley of the wonderful city, as well as a daughter of Steel, it's a joy to listen to Richard. So much of my own life and childhood being spoken to me. My mum has fond memories of trips to Clethrapees. Made me laugh out loud. I love it. I love it. Okay, Richard Hawley is with us to perform, there you go, another song for us here on 5 Live. And that song is called Tonight the Streets Are Ours.
Do you know why you got feelings in your heart? Don't let fear of feeling fool you. What you see sets you apart. And there's nothing here to bind you. It's no way for life to start. But do you know that tonight the streets are ours? 'Cause tonight the streets are ours. And these lights in our hearts, they tell no lies. They got nothing in their souls, and they make our TVs blind us from our vision and our goals. Oh, the trigger of time, it tricks you, so you have no way to grow. But do you know that tonight the streets are ours? Tonight the streets are ours. These lights in our hearts, they tell no lies. And no one else can haunt me the way that you can haunt me. I need to know you want me. I couldn't without you and the light that shines around you. No, nothing ever mattered more than not doubting. But tonight the streets are ours. Do you know how to kill loneliness at last? Oh, there's so much there to heal, dear, and make tears things of the past. Do you know that tonight the streets are ours? It's tonight the streets are ours. These lights in our street are ours. It's tonight the streets are ours. These lights in our hearts, they tell no lies.
Oh, my gosh. Richard, we've got 2 minutes left. Shez, thank you as well. Thank you very much indeed. Wow, that was so good. Richard Coleman in Shropshire said, loving Richard Hawley, also love his mate and collaborator Martin Simpson, best acoustic guitarist I have seen. Lovely to hear Richard on this afternoon, one of the greatest of Sheffield exports after Steel and Hendo's.
Henderson's relish.
Oh, is that right?
Okay. It's a condiment that's only made in Sheffield.
Ah, right.
Been made there for 100+ years.
Strong knowledge. I need to get involved in a bit of Hendo's.
You put a bit of that on, you know, you put hairs on your chest. Though my dad never used to say that to my sisters, you know what I mean?
When I first met my now wife, she was only into truly awful music. One play of Call's Corner and her music epiphany had begun. Loved your gig in Holmfirth earlier this year. Much love, Paul and Laura in Matlock. You have started a massive thing about people who change the names of places. I had a friend who moved out of London to Essex. She swore that she lived in Southend-sur-la-Mer.
I love it. I love it.
Southend-sur-la-Mer. Yes. Cas Vegas for Castleford and Pontesino for Pontefract.
Yeah, Chesterfield we call Ches Vegas, you know what I mean?
We had friends who lived in Clapham in London. They wanted to be posh, so they told everyone they lived in Clam. Silly. This is brilliant, this one, wasn't it?
Doncaster, that always gets called Doncatraz. Yeah.
Île des Chiens, the Isle of Dogs. That's what Chris in Sussex lives in.
Just get them all on there. Folder on a website.
It's so, Scarborough.
Yeah.
Scarbados.
Of course, yeah. Scarbados.
Scarbados. You started a massive thing.
That's
here.
Legendary, yeah.
Although I have to say the biggest laugh is definitely for Southend-sur-la-Mer.
Okay.
That seems to be the one that...
Result.
Richard, it's been such a pleasure, man. Two songs. The album Further is out. Where can people find out tour dates?
On the internet.
No. Go and check it out. Just put Richard Hawley in, put tour dates in, and he will come into your life. And after hearing those two songs, why wouldn't you want him in your life? Thank you, Richard.
Thanks a lot, Nihal. Really appreciate it, brother. Thank
Great
you.
Great to meet you, man. Now it's time for Drive with Anna and Tony.
Cheers, Nihal. Thank you very much. It's a shorter than usual drive today. Do we sound overexcited? We're off at 5.30. We're making way for Champions League action. Olympiacos play Spurs at 5 to 6. Then later it's Shakhtar Donetsk against Manchester City. A